have three people.
Smallest class I've been in this classroom yet.
Yeah.
Usually there's like at least five.
Yeah, we'll go with the three today, I guess. Alright, so welcome back everybody. Alright, so today we're going to wrap up chapter three. So this is the second half of National Cinemas. We're going to focus primarily on the United States. Classic Hollywood cinema. Any questions about anything, questions, concerns? So we have the exam coming up soon. Yes, go ahead.
So is it starting on the 22nd and then you can take it till the 29th?
That's correct.
Okay.
So I'll open it up for a week and you can take it anytime during that week.
It's not lockdown browser or anything?
I don't think it is a lockdown browser.
Like it's on iCloud?
Yes.
Like it's not like webcam? Like, you know, it's a...
Yeah, you just take it on iCollege. Multiple choice, 50 questions. If you follow my notes and PowerPoint, and you obviously, you know, you're here for the lectures, watch the lecture, whatever, you'll be fine. So if it's in the textbook and I don't go over it in my PowerPoint slides and my lecture notes, it will not be on the exam, right? Still make sure that you're reading the textbook. Oh, we got four. We have four. Chick-fil-A, what'd you get for Chick-fil-A today? Just the beverage? Vanilla milkshake, you said?
Yeah.
How is it? Extra vanilla today? What do you have?
Pumpkin spice latte.
Pumpkin spice, you're giving in to the pumpkin spice craze, huh? Did you enjoy pumpkin spice?
Yeah, so far so good. I mean, this is like my fifth to sixth one.
Today?
No.
Okay, I'm gonna say, wow, you are going pumpkin spice crazy, but no.
Since I've been here.
Do you find it to be very sweet? I find that those sort of drinks to be too sweet for my taste. I can't take it too long. I can't.
They are a little sweet. I told them to go a little light.
Every once in a while, like a frappuccino, right? I'm human, right? But yeah, I think once we get into the extra added flavors there, that's when I, no thank you to me, is what I say. What do you have, a Pepsi, classic Pepsi?
Yeah, just a classic. I prefer Coke. I'm a Coke guy, but they had a sale on that Publix for Pepsi products. So.
Excellent. All right. Well, it's good to have everybody here, all four of you.
Oh, did you hear that they were filming I think it was some Marvel thing down there.
Oh, we got five! Excellent! I can go with five.
I heard about that too.
So they're filming a Marvel movie right now.
Yeah,
I think
Captain
I don't know
America
if it's Marvel, but it was a big set.
Spider-Man and Captain Marvel, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's
okay.
What
they're
filming down there.
I thought they're filming Captain Marvel, but they put up a casting call for extras for Spider-Man.
Where are they filming it?
I'm not sure. Let me check.
Are they filming around campus?
Yesterday they were filming near the Capitol. So.
I wonder if that'll affect traffic at all when I'm trying to get home.
I went to the set to try to give them like my resume and become a PA, but no one would take it.
Okay.
If I see it again, I'm gonna just keep trying until eventually someone does.
Alright, excellent. Well, today we're talking about classic Hollywood cinema. Let's start off with our warm up question of the day. What is one app on your phone that you couldn't go without? Like, if you had to get rid of all the other apps on your phone except for one, what would be the one app that you could not go without? For me, it's clearly TikTok. I'm just kidding. I've never really used TikTok before. But for me, it'd probably be Spotify, right? Because I jam. Sometimes I jam, right? And then I like to listen to podcasts as well, but Spotify would probably be my go-to. Let's start over here. What about you? Pumpkin Spice? That's not a good nickname.
My go-to has been
Instagram. Insta, as I call it.
Yeah.
You call it the gram?
Yeah, so I do YouTube, so that's like one of my ways to like promote my video.
Promote yourself.
Yeah.
All right. So it's not YouTube. The YouTube app was is not the one that you couldn't go without.
Not necessarily. I mean, you can still. I mean, I need YouTube.
You can do everything on your computer.
Right.
Okay. Right. So Instagram, the Gram.
The Gram.
Do you call it the Gram or do you call it Insta?
I call it Instagram.
Does anyone call it Insta? Or is that just my? Is that my thing?
I think other people call it. I just always call it Instagram.
Right. Up next, the one app that you cannot go without.
Honestly, I don't know. It's between Instagram and YouTube.
Instagram and YouTube.
Because for me, I don't watch regular TV. I stay watching either YouTube or Netflix back to back. And Instagram keeps me entertained with like comedy stuff. Or, like,
who are you following on Insta right now?
There's this one comedian who's in Atlanta, actually. I just started following him, but he does like funny public interviews with people.
What's his name?
It was like brand new.
Chris Rock. No. This is his little known comedian. All right. Up next.
Ooh.
One app that you could not go without.
Usually I would say YouTube. But I'm gonna have to say Facebook. I hardly even use Facebook.
Okay.
But the reason I keep it is because it's surprising how much stuff and work you can find on Facebook.
I see. Like jobs, networking on the Facebook.
Yeah. That's probably the one. That or my camera. My camera.
Okay. All right. Excellent. Up next, what we got?
Probably like Crossy Road.
You say Crossy Road?
Yeah, it's a game, but like I just play it like whenever I'm bored or just on the court.
Tell me about Crossy Road. How is this different from like a Farmville or like a Words with Friends?
It's just a mindless game. Like an animal crossing the street, avoiding cars.
So it's Frogger.
Yeah,
pretty much.
Yeah.
Kind of like a modern version of Frogger. I used to play that all the time when it was
modern Frogger. Excellent. What we got next?
I don't know. It's either toss between Instagram or TikTok.
Okay. Do you TikTok?
Yeah, I post my art on Instagram or TikTok, so it's either one or the other.
This is what I know about TikTok. People dancing to music, right? Is that what?
Any person that has like a career with it, that's where it is. But otherwise, there's like everything now.
What I've noticed is I follow a lot of like fitness athletes, right?
Yeah.
And I noticed that some are starting doing TikTok videos now on Instagram, and I'm like, unsubscribe.
Yeah, no, literally.
I just can't take it anymore.
Yeah, the app is literally just everything.
I don't mind watching your fitness routine for today. I'm into it, but once you start singing and doing dances, then I'm done. Okay. I'm done. All right, so let's go ahead and talk about our lesson today. First of all, let's do a little summary. That was a fun little spin move. I like that. How would you sum up the last class? What are some go-tos? What are the main points, the hits?
It's like a space race, almost.
A film? Yeah.
And a space race in the sense that you're having these individual nations that are developing their own cinemas. But, but the reason why they're developing their own cinemas, or the reason why there are boundaries, is because
World War One
is sort of is creating concrete boundaries where we're getting like trade embargoes, we're getting imports are being banned. So whenever countries are sort of at war, they close the borders down, and that allows for these distinct film studios, national cinemas to start to form, and you start to notice some distinct artistic characteristics of each particular country, right? We talked about Russia, where you have these melodramas where they end up being very, somber endings, versus, what France, what was France known for?
France was...
Or any, or Germany?
Germany was, I don't know if that's authorism.
Oh, yeah. The Autorin film, mm-hmm. Right? Well, yeah, exactly. Okay. So you're getting these distinct genres of film based on the actual nation. Right, so let's go ahead and move on to, now we're focusing primarily on the United States, right? Because that's the whole lesson for the day. What is classic Hollywood cinema? How would you describe the characteristics of classic Hollywood cinema? Yes?
Factory-like production.
Yeah, factory-like production. This is a pretty good summary of, what does that mean though? When we say factory-like production, what are we talking about here? Yes?
It's kind of like what Tyler Perry does today, where it's like a lot of more quantity over quality. A lot of films that are around the same, kind of the same premise and all that.
Okay. A shout out to Tyler Perry for out of nowhere, but totally fine. That's totally acceptable. But yeah, so this idea of it is really quantity over quality. You're seeing the reusing of studio sets. A lot of times storylines are being recycled. A lot of the films seem very similar. You got the formulaic, like happy endings, romantic storylines, right? So you're seeing a lot of this mass production of films, recycling plots, that sort of thing. But what else? What else are we seeing in terms of, when we say factory-like production, what else are we talking about? Which can lead us to our next question. What techniques did production companies develop to make filmmaking more efficient? Right, we're talking about, because classic Hollywood cinema tends to be characterized by like efficiency, trying to generate efficiency. With any mass production, you want efficiency, right? So what does that look like?
Mm-hmm. Was it the like more like producer? Like, because there's more like a prominent role of producer?
That's certainly the case, yes. The producer is sort of like the prominent figure. Obviously they're financing the films, or they're finding the money for the film, but they're also putting together everything necessary for the film, so that they're like the primary figurehead, certainly. They have a more prominent role. Did we have something over here? No? Okay. What else are we talking about? When we talk about efficiency, what does it mean when we say that filmmaking is becoming more efficient? Yes?
There's the backlots.
Okay, yeah, so the use of backlots and dark studios, and we'll kind of get into that more detail. But what is a backlot? Anyone tell me what a backlot is? We still use backlots today. When I say we, not me. What's a backlot?
I'm going to go based off how, like, of it today. It's like basically they construct the sets. They construct these big sets they can use to save money because they can control more aspects in the studio than outside of location.
And these are outdoor facilities. They produce these large set pieces outside. Certainly, yes. Did you have someone? Oh, I keep seeing hands. Oh, no, you're good. What else can we talk about efficiency? What is a continuity script? What does that mean? That's one of the terms that the book discusses. What is a continuity script? Do you want to take a guess at that? Yes?
A shot list? Like, they break
the board? Yes, right. So a continuity script is this idea of you have this one script, and the script is for everybody, not just the actors, right, and the director, but everybody in the studio production, right? So everybody can read this script, whether they're set designers or costume designers or the actors, and everybody pretty much knows their role. And because of these continuity scripts, it wasn't necessary for individuals in different departments to communicate with each other because you're all going off the continuity script. So there's no need to, you know, talk to other people who are in other parts of the studio production, and tasks become very individualized, like factory-like production. Very good. Which leads us to our next question. Describe some notable people from this time period. Does anyone come to mind on that? Some notable figures during this time period? We're going to kind of get into
Charlie Chaplin.
Charlie Chaplin, yeah, we're going to talk about Charlie Chaplin. Who's Charlie Chaplin?
One of the bigger silent movie guys.
Yeah, it's the slapstick comedian, silent film, known for his bowler hat, his mustache, his cane. Walks around, does a lot of physical comedy. Right, we're going to watch a clip from that. Who else?
Buster Keaton.
Buster Keaton, right, which is sort of a precursor to Charlie Chaplin, certainly. Who else?
D.W. Griffin.
D.W. Griffin?
He appeared earlier, right? Didn't we discuss him earlier?
Yeah, we did discuss him earlier. Today we're going to talk primarily about Birth of a Nation, but D.W. Griffin, probably the most famous director during this time period. I guess he's like the Christopher Nolan, if you want to go in that direction, right? He's a very notable director during this time period. Obviously, he's known for Birth of a Nation, and we'll kind of get into how problematic Birth of a Nation is, and we'll talk about that here in more detail. But D.W. Griffin is a well-known figure. All right. Good. Let's go ahead and get started here. Skirt. All right, so we already kind of discussed it. So classic Hollywood cinema in the 1910s, you consider this to be sort of factory-like production. We talked about continuity scripts, we talked about the importance of the producer, we talked about the reusing of studio sets. This was also the time when many of the major studios are starting to form. So Paramount, Fox, MGM, Warner Brothers are starting to form during this time period. These are sort of the precursors to, in a later chapter, we're going to talk about the majors and the minors, right? These studios that are called the majors and the minors because they're the biggest studios in the country at the time. But right now, during the teens, we're starting to see the foundation, the starting of these studio systems are starting to form. Moving along. Adolf Zucker is a notable figure. He was a producer known for booking and sort of exploiting, exploiting is the right term, the Hollywood star system. So one of the more primary goals during this time period is trying to find a star. You want to find a celebrity and you want to try to make as many films with that celebrity as possible. You want to maximize on the profit from that celebrity. And what Adolf Zucker would do is he would do something called block booking. He owned so if you owned all the movie theaters, then you could do essentially what's called block booking, which is you force the theaters to play only your films. And you sort of exclude other films from being able to play. So if you have that stranglehold, you control what films are actually being shown. This was later later dissolved. You were by the Supreme Court. You're not allowed to do this anymore. Block booking was a prominent practice during this time period. We talked about backlots, these outdoor large facilities for filmmaking, and then dark studios are sort of similar to that. Can anyone tell me, or can anyone guess what a dark studio is? It's a dark studio. Yeah, everything's shot inside. There's no windows. It's designed to be. You completely control lighting artificially. So you have complete control. You're not worried about climate. You're not worried about, you know, if it's sunny outside, if it's gloomy outside. You completely control the lighting. And this is a time when directors are starting to experiment with lighting, with effect lighting, and we'll talk about that here in a second. But dark studios. A notable director, Cecil B. DeMille, a very notable figure in film history. One of the more noteworthy films is the film called The Cheat in 1915. This is known for using a lot of effects lighting. Can anyone tell me what effects lighting is? Anyone guess what effects lighting is?
Is it just lighting to portray like a cool effect?
Yeah, sure. Or either a cool effect, or like a cool aesthetic, or if you're trying to simulate natural light. If you're trying to simulate light from something else, right, to make it seem like it's coming from an actual real light source. Right? And what's notable about this, about Cecil B. DeMille, is that we're starting to get away from this idea of film being simply, I'm going to point my camera at a scene and just hit record and just let the performance happen, sort of like just a mediated theater. Right, performance. And now we're starting to experiment what film can actually be. Different camera angles, doing more close-ups to facial expressions, playing with lighting systems to create effects and create emotion. I do want to show an extended scene from The Cheat. And what I want you to do is I want you to pay attention to the use of lighting in this film and how it sort of enhances the affect, the feeling, the emotions of the scene that you're about to watch. Thank you. let's talk about this for a second. What would you say is noteworthy about the artistic expression from this director in terms of the use of lighting? What is being, what emotions, what feelings are being generated by this?
Well, definitely a dramatic sense. Like it makes the atmosphere more dramatic, and especially because it, how you use the lighting makes you focus more on the actors. Because if you notice, the actors are more well lit than the background, so it's not, they're not blended in. It's meant to focus you on the actors in the portrayal.
Okay, good. What else? Anything notable? Anything that you enjoyed about this scene?
I mean, the use of the silhouette against the thin
right
background. I think it adds more anxiety.
Yeah, definitely. Right. What else?
It doesn't have to do with the lighting, but it's more of the cameras, or they change the camera so that she's off screen when he brands her. That seems like he's doing it, actually.
Right, okay, good, yeah. Right. And that almost makes it even worse, right? Because we can't see it actually happening, right? What is where is the light coming from? Like, what, as an audience member, where are we assuming the lighting is coming from? Like, the natural light?
I guess the eyes overhead? Yeah, overhead in the room.
Okay.
Those two were in.
And there was a fire at one point. You heard the fire as well.
Oh, okay.
The light's coming from that fire. But yeah, so once again, we're effect lighting. That's just the use of lighting to generate these you know, complicated emotions, these complicated feelings. Great. That was a cheat, 1915. All right, moving along. Yes, question.
So I have a question. So like for the exam, for like, you know, the films that were shown, like the cheat and stuff like that, would we have to remember like why those films were significant, for example, like that used effects lighting?
Yes, right. So I'm never going to ask a question like, Birth of the Nation came out in what year? You're not going to see a question like that. But what you might see is Cecil DeMille's The Cheat is well known for using this technique. Something like that, right? And the effects light would be the correct answer. So as long as you know the general, what makes the film noteworthy, you should be fine. So let's talk about Thomas H. Ince. I actually don't have a clip from this one, but a film that he directed was called a film called Civilization, 1916, very noteworthy. Moving on to D.W. Griffith. All right, so let's talk about Birth of a Nation here for a second. So D.W. Griffith, probably one of the most famous directors during the time period. He is noteworthy because he sort of legitimized a theater, right? It became sort of this accepted art form, right? I mean, it got credibility because of a lot of films that he directed. And one of those films was Birth of a Nation. So if you're not familiar with Birth of a Nation, it is probably the most controversial film of all time. It was very popular during this time period. Many, many people saw it. In fact, it was actually, it was screened in the White House. Very successful film. I believe it's a 12-reel film. So if you think about reels of film stock, it's a very long film, especially during this time period. It's noteworthy for having great visuals. The use of tinting and toning, or primarily in tinting. But obviously, what makes this film so controversial is that it's extremely racist in the depiction of... Yes, right? So it's often... It's the film itself is sort of a glorification of the KKK. It's sometimes described as the very first vigilante film, right? Because it glorifies the KKK as this... justice-bringing entity. The film itself is set during the Civil War, and many times it depicts African Americans as, you know, recently liberated, and then the problems that happen when you liberate the black population, right? It's filled with white anxiety and white, like, fears of, you know, of a more diverse nation. And many of the depictions are strikingly racist, especially when using our eyes and looking back. Well, so There are actually many people, I shouldn't say many, there are those who believe that we should not show this film in class because there is a fear that it glorifies this film when we do this. I believe there's two mistakes that you can make. The first mistake would be just to show this film and say it was a noteworthy film, very popular film, and sort of legitimized theater during this time period, which it did, right? And then neglect to talk about all the racist components. And then the other mistake would be to just not show the film and ignore this film ever existed, right? I think that's a mistake too, because what it does do, what it does do when you look at this film, when you watch this film and you analyze it, you can clearly see the United States' racist past. And you can make connections with some of the negative depictions of African Americans with some of the same stereotypes that we have today. You can draw that line. And one of the more noteworthy or obvious connections is this idea of white vigilantism, right? Protecting the population from black people, right? Which today you still see with the Kenosha shooting. I mean, you can draw that line all the way to today where you have the Kenosha shooter. Is everyone familiar with the Kenosha shooter? The white kid who shot the protesters, right? Yeah, pretty recently. So the Kenosha shooter is a 17-year-old who crossed state lines with an assault rifle, and he shot a bunch of protesters in the name of defending the cops or whatever his justification was. So this idea of like this white savior vigilante, you can connect that all the way to this film, right? You can kind of see some of the same stereotypes. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to show a clip. And of course, every depiction of a black person in this film is by a white person in blackface. Just kind of give you a little, heads up on that. But we're going to watch a pretty long clip, and then I would like to talk about your thoughts on this. But here is a scene from The Birth of a Nation, 1915. Thank you. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to get your reaction from watching this scene, right? What are some things that you are noticing from this or just want to talk about? Yes.
Well, I've noticed that they portrayed that black man as almost an animal, like a rat.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure at one point I saw foam coming out of his mouth, or maybe I just saw it, but it's more like how he moved and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It wasn't like elegant like the lady. He moved more like rapid, almost like stalking his prey.
Right. Yeah. It's a gross representation, right? It's this monstrous other figure, right? And that's why, you know, it's whenever we talk about blackface today, and we sort of condemn those white people who wear blackface because of how it's rooted in this gross racist depiction of black people. Yes.
Well, I noticed, besides the one line the woman had, the two, or I guess the only other lines they gave to him, and they were kind of deceitful.
Yeah, okay, so, and, and we can kind of dissect his dialogue, right? So at one point he says, you know, I'm a captain now, right? But kind of building off the white anxiety of what happens when you, you know, free a black man, right? And he gets sort of this power, and what happens when you give a black man power, right? It's this—it's generating off of this white anxiety, right? Most certainly. Anything else that we notice?
I thought there were a lot of cool shots. Sorry.
So the shots are, you know, are beautiful in a lot of ways, which is even more, you know, concerning, right?
Yeah.
Definitely. Yes.
I think it gave into that white part, that idea you're talking about, like white vigilantism, because it showed how, I assume the father, I don't know the context, but like the father, the white father wanted to save his daughter from the black man or something, is showing that idea.
Right, many of the, like, the foundational, like, stereotypes are depicted in this film, not just with the black character, but with this idea of a white woman needing rescue, right? This white woman that needs to be saved at all costs. This depiction of innocence that needs to be protected. And what happens when this innocent white woman goes outside, right? This fear of white women leaving the safety of the house. And what happens when a woman goes outside, then you're getting all these dangers, right? Once again, it's these depictions, these racist depictions that you can still see are still deep-seated, are still rooted in today. And once again, you know, this idea of like white militantism, of the vigilantism that is very, very prominent today. Anything else? Let's move on. D.W. Griffith often tried to defend his film, saying that it wasn't racist and saying that he wasn't racist, because he did get criticism for this film. So he produced another film called Intolerance, 1916. This is often considered to be his apology for Birth of a Nation. Intolerance is essentially just showing various parts of history. And really, it's just a film where he's saying, you know, intolerance is bad, right? So I just want to show a quick clip from Intolerance, 1916. I still can't tell what she's eating. I want to say she's eating onions. Like a green onion.
Yeah, it looked like some vegetable plant.
As you can see here, you know, they're beautiful shots. Especially when you compare them to other films during this time period. And D.W. Griffith is known for a couple of things, including the way he frames shots. As you can see here, you can see sort of like a a black circle around it, where it kind of frames it in a little bit, kind of bring a little focus. You can see that there. Of course, we got some tinting. The different colors are intended to depict, either various locales or different emotions. There we go, we got blue. We have more close-ups on reactions, facial expressions. So you can see there we got the blue, so she's outside, so blue, and we got the inside, so it's a little, yellow. But that's from Intolerance.
I thought it was interesting how they did the audio for the gunshots too. Like they probably just got like two pieces of wood and slapped it together.
Right, and once again, what you're hearing has been added onto YouTube later, so there's a good chance that sound you were actually not hearing. Any sort of music that you would have heard during this time period would have been either a live performance, or it would be some other sort of sound technology that would be playing along with the projection. Alright, moving along. That was. Alright, so let's move on to some fun things. Here we go. Slapstick comedies and westerns. So let's talk about Charlie Chaplin. We talked about him a good bit. This is a scene from a film called The Pawn Shop in 1916. The Pawn Shop. Just a little fun, little slapstick comedy. Yes, right. Yeah, this is a kind of a precursor to Three Stooges. We'll talk about Three Stooges in a later chapter.
But these like sound effects were not that good.
Yeah. So the sound effects, these weren't captured from in filming. They were added later on.
But these weren't added by YouTube.
I don't know. So I think you're asking, is this the actual original sound that was playing? I don't know the answer to that question. Possible. Sure. Up next, we have, so it's about Westerns. William S. Hart was a former stage actor who switched to film at the age of 50. So he was relatively older. He was known for the good bad guy character, right? The anti-hero character. And this is a scene from Night of the Trail, 1915, William Hart. And of course, you know, Aladdin came out in 1910. All right. Up next we have, let's talk about animation. All right, so we're starting to see the streamlining of animation in terms of, does anyone know what cell animation is? What's cell animation?
I used to know.
You use cell animation?
Yeah, I used to know about cell animation. I used to see
Do you remember at all what cell animation is?
First of all,
you took an introduction to digital media in high school?
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Yes, sir.
All right. But cell animation?
For the most part, I've known it's like layered, kind of. Like it was like a layered.
Yep.
I forgot what specific layer it was, but I know it was pretty much layered.
You're definitely on the right track, yes.
There's just a whole bunch of.
Right, so once again, it gets down to efficiency. It's trying to find an efficient way to create these animated films. And cell animation is you have these transparent pages and you layer them on top of each other. You draw one image and then you slightly change the image to make it seem like there's a movement, right? You just flip the actual cell. And I want to show you a quick little video on cell animation.
Example of a character doing a head turn and take. The animator first draws out the main key poses that are necessary for telling the story. In this case, there are three main poses only. The starting position, the glance pose, and the change of expression pose at the end. Those three drawings alone define what has to happen in this scene. After the animator is satisfied with how those work, then he has to figure out how he's going to move from one pose to the other. And he does that by creating breakdown poses, which define more specifically the individual movements. And remember in the previous lesson, I explained that you should not just animate from one major pose to the next in a straight line, but you have to add properly positioned breakdown poses, which creates arcs and a more full movement. And if done correctly, it will make the movement believable and beautiful to watch. Then the animator can tie those drawings down, and this is what it looks like with those breakdown poses added in. Next, the animator puts any instructions and timing charts on those poses.
So the timing charts and everything, that's, once again, that kind of goes back to like a continuity script.
Right.
That's cell animation. Here's an example of animation. This is of The Artist's Dream, J.R. Bray, 1913.
Thank you.
Okay, I think that's all we have for today. But first, does anyone have any questions about anything? All right, so what it's going to look like the next couple of days. I know we kind of ended up, we kind of breezed it this afternoon class. So next class, we're going to talk about German Expressionism. And then the following class, we're going to talk about Soviet Montage. Those two artistic movements are probably the two most influential artistic movements in film history. We're going to talk about those examples extensively. The exam's coming up soon. Exam one will be on every chapter up to Soviet Montage. And then the following chapter, which will be sound, will start what you'll need to start preparing for exam two. But does anyone have any questions, concerns? How is that pumpkin spice?
It's kind of nasty now.
It's
melted a little bit, so now it's like a little watery.
Yeah. What about your vanilla shake? Is that still good?
Excellent.
All right, well, that's it. I will see you next class. Don't forget to like and subscribe.
Roll with the 1 minute.
Ring the bell.
All right. No comments? Come on.
Why someone comment? Because you said that before you end the stream.
Wait, hold on. No comments. No.